Over the last few weeks, we've been studying from Hebrews and just looking on the as far as the inheritance of the spirit field, not Hebrews, but Romans. And we've come to study some about how the Holy Ghost brings deliverance to us. And we've looked at the abundant life and vitality. And we've brought how the Holy Ghost brings us understanding and the fellowship and prayer. We covered that some last week. And then we studied power as the ability and for the power to witness. And that's referencing Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He says, "You shall be witnesses unto me." But today, we're going to continue on. And the last two things I want to look at is how the Holy Ghost brings the fire of God, and also how it brings a passion for the lost people. And so starting there, we want to begin in St. Matthew chapter 3, verse 11. And it says, "Indeed," and this is John talking to some of the people here, and he says, "I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand," and we'll cover the fan in a couple weeks, "and whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And I want to read St. Luke's account also, chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. "John answered, saying unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." And today, first of all, fire. We look at the Holy Ghost and with fire, but today we're going to spend some time looking at fire. You know, and the fire, when we begin to look at this, you know, it begins to state or begin to look at as heaven's symbol for moral passion. And that's the passion to choose right. That's the passion to do right. But when you receive the fire, also you receive God's love. And seeing the Holy Ghost, when it baptizes you in fire, you know that the Spirit-filled people, souls become ablaze for God. And we're going to tie all this in as we go. But the fire in the most baseline, the most root meaning of that word, it means to be flaming or it means to be hot. And of course, we can cross-reference that with being lukewarm, you know, being hot, you know, being cold. But you know, if you're full of the Holy Ghost, you're going to be a hot Christian. So fire, in its first stance of our life and what it does for you and I, first of all, it is for purifying. Fire does this. And we begin to start in Malachi chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. "But who may abide in the day of His coming, and who shall stand when He appeareth? For He is like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. And He shall sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and He shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that He may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness." And see, when you and I begin to be purged by God, when it says we will offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness, that is in right doings, but that is, He first has to refine us and He first has to come and clean us. Begin the cleansing process. See, God spoke to Ezekiel about this. Chapter 22, verses 18 through 20. I'll read quite a bit of scripture. We'll begin to tie all this together. And it says, "Son of man, the house of Israel is become dross." See, what did they become? They become polluted. And if you don't allow the fire of God in your life, see, you'll become that. We can associate dross, and the Bible deals so much with refining and deals with silver, deals with gold, deals with impurities and things. So if we are not hot people, the Lord cannot purge us. You know, we can take a component of silver and or of gold, and the more it's refined, the purer it becomes. You know, we start at 10, 12, 14, 20, 24. We work our way up. But see, it's only as you and I maintain our consistency of being hot, that we can even be purged from the dross or the impurities in our life. But see, God looked at, told Ezekiel, and He told the house of Israel that they had become dross. You know, you had become polluted. You know, He said that they are brass and tin and iron and lead in the midst of the furnace. They are even the dross of silver. See, and when He begins to say that word dross, all that is the scum of silver. That is the things that come to the top, the impurities that boil itself out of silver, out of the refining process, that the refiner comes and skims the impurities off the top. See, Israel had done this, but they had become polluted. They had become lukewarm, and they had come to a place where there's no longer listening to the Word of God. And it says, therefore thus saith, or they could listen to the Word of God, but they wasn't doing the Word of God. And it says, therefore thus saith the Lord God, because ye are all become dross, behold, therefore I will gather you in the midst of Jerusalem, as they gather silver and brass and iron and lead and tin in the midst of the furnace to blow the fire upon it, to melt it, so will I gather you in mine anger and my fury, and will leave you there and melt you. See, and see, this is the fire of God. We always look at the fire of God. A lot of times we talk about it. You know, Jeremiah, we'll look here in a few minutes, you know, it's fire shut up in my bones. We talk so much about fire, but also Jesus Christ here said that in verse 17 of St. Luke, when He said His fan is in His hand and He's going to thoroughly purge His floor, and He will gather the wheat into His garner, but the chaff He will burn with unquenchable fire. See, when we begin to look at that, we have to cross-reference what Ezekiel said, is that, you know, if you've become dross, you know, see, when the fan is in God's hand, you know what He does when a garner is separating wheat and chaff, you know, they find a windy area, they throw all that up together, you know, and the chaff blows away and the wheat falls back down into the blanket to which they're throwing it. You know, that's how you thrash wheat, and that's how it separates, you know, the chaff from the wheat. So see, as you and I, as the Lord's going to burn the chaff with unquenchable fire, see, the same ones here that have become dross to God, they begin to refuse the Word of God, they become polluted in their mindset. But see, Proverbs 24 and 5, it says, take away the dross from the silver, and there shall come forth a vessel fit, or a vessel for the finer. See, He has to remove the impurities from us to even give God something to work with. See, He's trying to work us, He's trying to grow us, and all this. And I was praying one day, and I was praying this prayer to God, and I said, God, you know, remove the dross from me. Lord, thoroughly purge me. You know, God, you know, we're just praying all these prayers. You know, of course, that says a lot when we say that. But the Lord spoke to me and says, you cannot be purged unless you're hot. You know, He spoke it to me. And the reason why He said that, if we were to take a piece of metal and never heat it up, you could never separate the impurities from that metal. You can polish it. We can maybe make it look good somewhat on the outside, but it's still full of impurities. You know, and the Lord just spoke right to me. And that was just a revelation to me for that day. You know, I have to stay hot. That is, I can no time in my life get lukewarm to the things of God if I'm ever going to remove the dross from the silver. You know, we can polish the outside, we can polish things and make it look good, but you know, Christ dealt with that also when He says, inwardly they are full of dead men's bones. See, He's trying to get you and I to hot and trying to get you and I purged. See, Job said in 23 verse 10, He says, but He knoweth the way that I take. And when He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. See, and see, that gold is God. See, when you and I begin to look at these things, we're going to come forth as gold. You know, God purges you and I. He puts us in these places that you and I can conform into the image of Christ. See, that's when we are baptized in the Holy Ghost and with fire. See, we're receiving something that's going to burn out impurities. And just through this process of time, see, the Lord is just trying to work us. He's trying to make us. And I really have to begin to question, and not as, I don't want to question our salvation or question things and people as much, but we do know we have things to look at that we say we've increased with goods. I say that I've received all these things of God, but yet if I don't do things pertaining to God, I have to maybe ask myself, you know, what's actually moving in me? Because the Bible does speak of a spirit of truth and a spirit of error. See, so and on with this, as you and I have received the Holy Ghost, see, we have received a love, you know, a love that grows and a love that glows. Because Romans 5 and 5, when it says, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So see, if all I present from this vessel is one of arrogance and one of pride and one of hatred and one of not loving people, you know, not being a partaker of the natures of God, see, I have to maybe ask, you know, what am I truly born of? See, when you receive the Holy Ghost, you know, and the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, and we got to hear probably one of the best messages we ever heard on the love of God, you know, maybe Monday night. You know, when Dad was preaching that and dealing with that, so, you know, and I say that I've got the love of God, but he says, why call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? You know, do I really have the love of God in my life? Because the love of God is to keep His commandments. You know, and then again, he says, they believe, you know, people that are filled, you know, with the Holy Ghost, we should have a faith that is fervent. You know, when we begin to look at Hebrews chapter 11, you know, we always preach the faith side of things. You know, they had a faith that believed God, their testimony. You know, they believe and done what they said. Then they even had the ones that, you know, the whole message of the other side of faith. You know, some were delivered, but the Bible also says some were sawn asunder, some were killed, you know, but yet they both possessed faith, and that faith was fervent. You know, so sometimes our faith ain't always for deliverance. Sometimes we, you know, people had to die for this thing, you know, and not everybody got delivered. Some were thrown in the fire, some were delivered, some were burned up, you know, and that's just, but they had a faith that was fervent. You know, they still had a testimony of Jesus Christ. But then here we go. And I say that, you know, we say we're, this is more of a, this what I'm getting ready to say is more for a message, I guess, for people that say they're baptized in the Holy Ghost. You know, we always, a lot of times Pentecostal people put a lot of emphasis on this, which we should. But, you know, but the thing that if I say I've got this, I'll also possess a devotion that consumes me. You know, I'll have something. I'll have an inward fire in me. It's just not something I say I've received it to speak in tongues when I want to or just a little something like that. But we're going to be consumed with a devotion that's going to love the things of God because it's the fire of God. It's an inward fire. And that word devotion, see, it just commitment. You know, the commitment of God. If I say I have something, but yet I can't be committed to the things of God, you know, am I living to the spirit of truth or am I living to the spirit of error? But see, so the Holy Ghost in you and I consumes us with a devotion. You know, and so oftentimes it's hard to get people's commitment to the things of God, but yet they'll stand back and say, I've received all this. They say we're born again. Then they say we're baptized in the Spirit of God and everything we say, but yet there's no devotion in that life. So see, we have to ask ourselves, and I'm not judging everybody out, but still we have to know that the Bible does tell us that He's going to baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Now, we will have a devotion that will consume us. And all that says is we'll want the things of God. We'll desire the things of God. You know, but Christ, He had a mission. You know, and we know that He came to seek and to save that which was lost, but He also came to do more than that. From St. Luke 12, verses 49 and 50, He says, I am come to send fire on earth, or on the earth, and what will I if it be already kindled? But I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how am I straitened till it be accomplished? See, He had a pressure of a duty on Him. He knew that He come to do the will of God. He knew that He had something that, you know, that the angels desired to look into. He knew that He had something, and He knew that He had to do it. And that is the baptism to be baptized with. See, John already dealt with that. You know, he said we've been baptized in the water, but then above and beyond that, Christ said that I'm straitened until this be accomplished. And see, there's some things here I want to cover in Hebrews, just a few verses. I'm just going to read it. But Hebrews talks so much about this. The Lord's put me in the book of Hebrews for a while, and I don't know how many times I've read it. He's trying to show me something, but I'll just read to you what He's already talked to me a little bit about. But Hebrews 9, verses 6 through 12, and Hebrews 9, 22 through 24. And this just begins to deal a little bit more with Christ's mission, the reason why Christ came. It says, now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. Okay, but into the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he had offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. And that is, he entered into the holiest of the holies, And it says, "See, the Holy Ghost," this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as yet the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, but which stood only in meats and drinks and in divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation, or that is the fullness of time. But Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. And we'll look into that more next week about the building, the habitation of God by the Spirit. It says, "Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by His own blood He entered into once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us." Then in verse 22, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood is no remission. It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these." And what was he talking about? What the things that were purified in verses 6 through 12. "But," and it says, "but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ is not entered into the holy place made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor yet that he should offer unto himself often, as the high priest entered into the holy place every year without blood of others." And I want to stop right there just a minute. See, in what the way was made, see, this is all things pertaining to Christ. And we read there in the last verse that, you know, Christ entered in to this for you and I. And the Bible deals so much about the veil being taken away, the veil being broken. But it all deals with that the Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way of the holiest of all was not yet made manifest. See, that was Christ's mission. So He come in, you know, and He said, even we begin back in the garden when God says your kind can never enter into this place again. See, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, come, you know, when He died on Calvary's Hill, you know, the Bible says that the veil was rent in twain. You know, that was both spiritual and that was probably also natural. You know, when those priests walked into that temple that morning and they saw that 9-inch veil ripped in half, you know, I believe it actually happened too, not as also spiritual also. You know, they had to wonder, you know, what just happened. See, Christ entered in for you and I. See, He's sitting at the right hand of the Father glorified. Not only that, He's there to make intercession for the saints, but He's also come, you know, to baptize us with a baptism, you know, and that is the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And see from St. Luke 12 and 50. So, you know, that's just kind of a skimming description of that. But see, all the things that Moses did, and all the things that Moses did according to the pattern, was all signifying something that Hebrews chapter 9 begins to elaborate on, that the way of the holiest had not been made way yet, but it was all pertaining to Christ. And see, and the Lord wants to do this for you and I. And see, then as we begin to grow, you know, and if I say I have the Spirit of God, see, we begin to desire, you know, to hear the Word of God. And not only to hear it, but to have a desire to do the Word of God. St. Luke 24 and 32. "And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while He talked with us by the way and while He opened to us the Scriptures?" See, you know, does my heart still burn within me? You know, it's so easy, I guess, to become lukewarm. I think I've experienced that before. You begin to lose the simpleness that is in God, the simplicity that's in Christ. Sometimes we begin to lose, you know, just our devotion to God. Sometimes the Word of God no longer really affects us the way it used to, you know. And that is, you know, what happens is we begin to lose the joy of our salvation. We begin to lose that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, bled and died for us. And, you know, and God's sitting here talking to us in one of the greatest love letters ever written, you know, and my heart's no longer tender to that, you know. And so you and I, you know, let's be cautious and let's always understand, you know, that, you know, when the Word of God is preached and when I read the Word of God in prayer and stuff, you know, does my heart still burn within me? You know, does God still love me? Or, you know, God still loves me, but do I still love God, you know, just to do the things of God? Because the Bible tells us That God is a consuming fire. And we hear that read a lot, Hebrews 12 and 29, but the context of the Scripture, when it says God is a consuming fire, speaks above and beyond just saying He's a consuming fire. What God is dealing with is refusing the counsel of God. See, and we're going to look at this. We've already talked about, see, Christ said that He's going to burn the chaff with unquenchable fire, and then we hear that God is a consuming fire. So let's step back a few verses and understand the context of what this verse is actually saying. In verse 25 of Hebrews 12, it says, "See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not who refused him that speaketh on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, Yet once more I shake not earth only, but also heaven. And this word yet once more signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that the things that which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. See, for our God is a consuming fire." And see, when I read this, we have to study and look back to what Ezekiel was saying, that he was going to take all the ones that had become dross and melt them, you know, right in Israel. See, that God was a consuming fire. But then this consuming fire begins to look back into the divine counsel of God. St. Luke 12, 58 and 59, when it begins to talk about, you know, "When thou goest with thine adversary to the magistrate, as thou art in the way, give diligence that thou mayest be delivered from him, lest he hale thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and the officer cast thee in the prison. I tell thee, thou shalt not depart thence till thou hast paid the very last mite." See, when we look at that scripture, Jesus Christ, a couple verses before that, began to deal with the hypocrites. And what he's saying is there, when we look at Hosea chapter 4, verse 1, see, our adversary, in times of our disobedience, God becomes our adversary. Because, and let me read Hosea 4, 1 first. It says, "Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel, for the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land." And see, that word controversy, when you study that, one of the definitions of controversy is adversary. And see, when you and I stand before God and God looks at that life of mine, of Jeremy, and points his finger at me and says, "Jeremy, you're not doing something right." See, you know, I have to do what the Bible says. See, God is a consuming fire. You know, He wants to purge away the dross. He wants to cleanse me. He wants to do all this for me. But that's only the weak that He's going to do that to, only to the hot. See, if I refuse Him that speaketh, you know, I'll begin to fall in that category as the chaff. Because the Word of God, you know, whose fan is in His hand, you know, if I hear the Word of God, I'll be counted as wheat. But if I disobey God, I'll be counted as chaff. You know, then He said He's going to burn that chaff with unquenchable fire. See, I want to be one that agrees with my adversary. That is, in the sense, if God is my adversary, if He comes to me and shows me something that's not right. Because St. Matthew 5 and 25, it says, "Agree with thine adversary quickly while thou art in the way with him." See, when God, the Word of God comes to you and I, the tenderness of my heart sitting there and the Lord's trying to grow me and show me a little something wrong, you know, I have to agree with what He's saying to me. You know, it's, you know, through the process of time, you and I can, to override the Word of God becomes very easy through the process of time. So it's very important that I agree quickly with my adversary. See, we're still talking about a fire that is to purge you and I. See, and it's trying to clean us up, but you know, we have to maintain, you know, the desire to hear and the desire to be obedient to the Word of God. But see, and then again, the Spirit of God, you and I, in us, you know, gives you and I a joy. We have a joy in there. See, when you look at joy, you know, it's the emotion. invoked by well-being. Is it well with our soul? And it's not only the emotion that's invoked by well-being, but it's also caused by success or good fortune or by the prospect. Now listen to this. It says, and Webster had this figured out when he wrote it, I think. And he says, or by the prospect of possessing what one desires. To have the joy of the Lord. Is it invoked by me? Is it at the prospect that I know that I possess what I desire? See, that's the joy of the Lord. That I know that He's in me and I know that He's dwelling in me. And when He comes in there, He gives you and I joy. But is that invoked, that emotion, realizing that it's by my well-being that I possess what I desire and He desires to live in me? See, that's just joy. And see, Romans 14 and 17, it says, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it says, it's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. See, is that joy invoked by the emotion, invoked by my well-being, by the prospect of possessing what I desire? See, that is the joy in the Holy Ghost. Do I possess that? And if I do possess that, it will bring joy to us. Christian people, I heard Brother Lanham say last night, it was good to hear it. He says, he heard a preacher saying, I've always had a mountaintop experience. And see, what he was saying was, he began to kind of think, well, that don't sound quite right. But what the man of God was saying, he says, sometimes I'm on the mountain, sometimes the mountaintop is on me. See, it is through up and down all this, we can still have the joy of the Lord. And that's, sometimes it's hard to get that out, but we still know that what's greater in me is greater than what's in this world. Do I believe that? See, the love of God is perfected in the fire of God. He's trying, to get rid of the flesh. The cross is an instrument for this flesh. And that's just what it is. So see, love is perfected in the fire of God. He's trying to thoroughly purge His floor. He's trying to get me, trying to get flesh out of the way. He's trying to try me, just like Job said, and try to get us to come forth as gold. When we see a candlestick all of gold, when Zerubbabel saw that, he saw a church that was all of God. That was full of God. And that's what the Lord wants to do with you and I today, is to let you and I become a vessel that's all of gold, that's all of God, that God can pour Himself through. And we are always trying to love, but that the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. See, the love of God is in you and I if we've been filled with the Holy Ghost. But see, we've been filled with the love of God. But why don't we see sometimes more of it coming forth? And that is the restraint on my life is just the flesh nature. See, and that's what we must deal with. Is my flesh nature that the Lord can perfect in me, that the Lord can grow me, that He can burn out in me the things that are not right. See, He's going to set it as a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. See, fuller's soap makes something extremely white. It's a little bit abrasive sometimes, but it's white. And sometimes you and I have to eat this word. It might be sweet to the mouth, but bitter to the stomach. But still, we have to do it. The Lord's trying to purge you and I, and the flesh hates to be purged, but that's just what we have to do. See, that is the fire of God in us. See, it is the fire of moral passion to do everything that we just talked about. See, a joy that radiates. The fire of God will give you the desire to hear the Word of God. That is because He is a consuming fire. It will be that we have God's love, and we will have God's fire. And it's still above and beyond the fire of God that we're talking about. It's going to lead us into the place that you and I will have a passion for lost people. The love of God to do that. How can I say that I've got the kingdom of God in me? We always quote the scripture, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation, but the kingdom of God was within. We love to quote that and that's shouting ground if I truly believe it, if it's truly there. But even though if I say that, we can do everything we want to do, but if I don't have a heart for the lost people, I do not have the mind of God. There's a spirit of truth and there's a spirit of error. So God is trying to bring me to a place that if I say I have the Holy Ghost, how can I but not say that I have the mind of God? If we say we're born again, and that seed of that life is in there, and we're trying to do the Word of God, trying to do the things of God, the Lord will lead you and I to a place that you and I will love lost people, and we'll begin to love people. So again, starting in Romans 1, or Romans 9, verses 1, 2, and 3. And I understood what I just said there was kind of sharp. I also understand that, you know, it's close and it cuts me just as much as it cuts anybody. But still the Lord is trying to get me to love people. That's what He's wanting us to do, is to have a burden for the lost. I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. His conscience bearing him witness in the Holy Ghost, because he said that I have great heaviness and continued sorrow in my life. What was that? What was that sorrow? See, it was the bearing the witness in the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost was bringing to him to a place of heaviness and continued sorrow in my heart. He says, "For I could wish that myself were accursed for Christ, for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh." See, that the experience of Pentecost brings a passion for the souls of men. And see, if we don't have the burden for the lost, then the main need that I need to focus on in my life is to pray back through to the experience, the experience of the Spirit of God. We must do that. If I find myself that I don't love people, that I don't care for people, you know, my first thing I need to do is get back to the altar, saying, "Man, I've lost something here. Something's not right." You know, and you know, the altar, every time it was built in the Old Testament, the New Testament, it always had the same result. It brought a person back in touch with God. That's what the altar's for. So see, if you're sitting here this morning, you think, "Man, I just don't care for people the way I need to." Okay, just stop what you're doing and get back to the altar. Get back to the experience of being born again, or not even much as actually you've got the birth, but get back to the experience, you know, of saying that I've got the life of God flowing through me. You know, get the flesh out of the way. You know, let's get things taken care of. See, so we need every day to pray through to a newer, greater, deeper experience in the Holy Ghost. See, and that is, Paul says, the inward man is renewed day by day. See, this is, you burn oil up. I mean, that's just what the oil is. You know, when you have the oil of God in you, you know, it's something that is consumed. You know, in the candlesticks that Zerubbabel saw was fed by two living olive trees. That means there's a continual supply coming in that. So I couldn't dare try to get up here in this pulpit this morning and preach something and just relying on the experience that I prayed 2 weeks ago. See, I had to get a hold of God this morning, let Him speak to me so I could have something to speak to you. You know, we consume this stuff. You know, the Holy Ghost ain't consumed, but you know, but through and by you and I, we have to maintain, you know, the lifeline. We have to maintain, you know, the refilling, the renewing, the rededicating, the deeper experience, the deeper depths, the higher heights. You know, when they was writing in the Scripture, you know, eyes not seen nor ears heard, that means it don't matter how much I do as much, you know, God is still going to have something new for me. He said, "Seek out the old path and walk therein." So see, there's nothing new to God. It's just new to me. It's just new to you. And that's just the vastness of God. So we have to pray through to the experience, you know, just to maintain the experience, you know, and pray through to the desire of God and maintain the desire of God. And I know it gets difficult sometimes. I mean, I'm flesh too. I was born, you know, I was just like Dave, you know, we was born of woman in sin, we was shaping in iniquity. Every one of us was like that until we was born again. That's just what the Bible says. And so we have to deal with that. So I'm not sitting here trying to teach a holier-than-thou experience with God, but I do know that when we've received it, we've received all power. And as I walk in that, we can walk in all power. That's what it's for, you and I. So see, let's keep the experience of life, and see that the experience of the Holy Ghost brings you and I to a place of anguish, you know, extreme pain, extreme distress, you know, for the tears of the lost. You know, if I truly believe, you know, that my dear child, you know, my loved one is going to go to hell and burn forever, do I even believe that to a place that I'd even pray an hour for them a day? Do I believe that I'd push my meals back? Or do I just walk around this life happy-go-lucky saying, "Oh God, they're in your hands," and you don't spend no time on your knees? You have no anguish and you have no care for that child. That's just what it is. You know, it's good to say put them in the hands of God, but you know, also you and I have to intercede. You know, the Bible tells you and I to do that. So do I have an anguish, you know, for the lost people, you know, for the people in my family? You know, I don't know your family the way you know them, and you don't know mine the way I know them. So you and I have to pray for people. But see, praying through to the experience of Pentecost will enable me You know, and I should have a desire for the lost people. You know, and I just want to stress that. You know, I try to spend time on my knees for my children, but you know, who's going to pray for them? You know, I mean, the best you and I can do is barely remember the people in our own family. But do I have an anguish? You know, do I understand that they're going to spend eternity in a lake of fire if I don't travail with God? See, intercessory prayer. See, you can read in the Bible that Moses changed God's mind. See, and you say, well, how's that possible? See, we serve a God that's merciful. We serve a God that's loving and caring and everything that He is. And He has turned away His wrath because of intercessory prayer. He's done that. He's a God. You know, He's a God that does not change. He's a God that does not lie. So you and I can have a prayer that prevails because He just promised that. We can do that. But do I believe if I don't have anguish that my family will die lost and be forever? They'll be looking across that great gulf just like as the rich man did. They'll see us in paradise in Abraham's bosom. And sitting there doing that, do I believe that's where they'll end up at if I don't travail with God? See, that's close also. I hope y'all are enjoying this. But anyway, so it will give us the zeals for the souls of men. It's going to do that. See, St. John 4:35, Christ began to deal with something here. And He says, this is the Scripture, you know, the setting behind this is when Jesus began to talk with the woman at the well, the Samaritan. And see, the Samaritans at that time wore white attire, you know, and so he began to say that the fields are white with harvest. See, what that began to culminate, to talk about, see, the Christ was telling them, hey, you know, salvation's probably no longer for the Jews. You know, we're going to begin to bring in these people that were once counted as dogs also. That's one thing it was talking about. And He says, say not ye that there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white, already to harvest. You know, so see, there's no sterner test of grace than the attitude that I have toward the lost. You know, do I offer them the grace that I've received? You know, I can't give them the grace of God. But do I know, or do I have the heart in me to understand that I was once a vile, wretched sinner, and that I can look at them and say, you know, I was once in that field ready to harvest, and now, you know, God, let me see what You see as much as possible. Lord, help me to feel what You feel as much as possible. It's not possible for us to do and feel everything that God does, but He can give us a burden. You know, do I see that the fields are white with harvest? Do I have a burden? Do I have an anguish to know that people are going to spend eternity separated from God in hell, and then hell's going to be cast into the lake of fire? See, that's just what's going to happen. Do I believe that? And that should, you know, the Spirit of God will put an anguish, a burden on you. It'll just do that. Ezekiel 9, verses 3 through 6. Now, something stood out to me in this, and I'll point this out. Actually, where this begun at. But let's read this. We've heard this before, but I want to read it again. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub. Okay, now see, the cherub overshadowed the mercy seat. But see, the glory of God left that area. But then where did He go? Whereupon He was to the threshold of the house. And He called to the man clothed with linen, which had a writer's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. See, they received a mark for their intercessory prayer. Are we so marked today? Verse 5. And to the others He said in my hearing, go ye after him through the city, and smite, let not your eyes spare, neither have you pity. See, okay, one was setting the mark, one was putting the mark on the forehead that cried for the abominations. You know, they had a heart for the lost because of the sin. They was not desensitized to sin. They still hated sin. They knew that it was wrong, and they were just crying for it. You know, oh God, help us. But then He sent the others out to go behind them and smite the ones that didn't have the mark. But verse 6, slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark. But listen what He said, and begin at my sanctuary. See, judgment begins at the house of God. See, he begun that mark in the sanctuary. We're not going to go out in here in the world and mark people that don't have the life of God. This inkhorn is in this house today. You know, it's in the sanctuary. He says, begin here. You know, so, you know, am I one when that man with clothed with white linen comes up to me? Is he going to mark my forehead and saying, hey, this is one that has the heart of God that's crying for the abominations? Or am I going to be the one that the other in the hearing is going to go in the city and smite and let not your eyes spare? Neither have ye pity. See, mercy rejoices against judgment. See, that's what God is saying. If I don't have pity on the lost, God's not going to have pity on me. You see what this is very close to understand that. But see, Ezekiel's saying something. He said, but begin this at my sanctuary, you know, in the house of God. The Bible is written for you and I. You know, we can preach a message and say, oh, the world's got awful, the world's got awful. No, it didn't. The church got awful. See, there's always been sin in the world. See, Ezekiel's saying, I'm going to start this in the house of God. These are people that come to church on the Sabbath day, sit around, listen to the law and do everything, but they don't have nothing to do with it. They just sit and listen to it. See, that stood out to me. Begin at my sanctuary. That should stand out to all of us this morning. You know, God wants us to do right. He loves us enough to do. He's trying to get us to come in as a brood. You know, he said, oh, you know, Jerusalem, oh, Israel. You know, how often did he try to gather them as a hen would the brood under his wings? He's trying to do that for you and I because he loves us. But, you know, if I turn a deaf ear to the one that speaketh, as Hebrews 12 said, the Bible said that my God is a consuming fire. See, that's the context that saying that in, is that he's a consuming fire and he will thoroughly purge his floor. Yes, he's a consuming fire. He's going to purge the ones that's going to be purged, but then he's going to burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. See, God is still a consuming fire. Then Pentecost. The Holy Ghost will lead you and I back to Gethsemane. And what happened to Gethsemane? Matthew 26, verse 36 through 39. Then cometh Jesus with them unto the place called Gethsemane, and said unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and watch with me. And he went a little further, and fell on his face, and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But then, nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. See, the Holy Ghost leads us to a place to die out to our will. See, Romans 12 and 1 takes on a new meaning in this Scripture. And it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. See, that's not for the ones that are lost and undone. But see, this takes on even a deeper meaning. You know, Christ presented that body. Now, you and I are the sacrifice. We know that Christ was the morning sacrifice because the Bible says the morning sacrifice, the blood was removed from the body. Then it was those parts was separated from the blood. That's when Christ said that He suffered without the gate, you know, or outside the camp. You know, that's what Hebrews was talking about when it said that. But see, this takes on new meaning for you and I. You know, it will lead us to a place to pray, nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. See, Christ never prayed that prayer. He never entered into the wilderness until after the Holy Ghost descended upon him like as a dove. That's the Word was made flesh and dwelt among men. It will bring us to a place that we will truly say, but as thou wilt. You know, Christ, He says, lo, I come in the volume of the book to do thy will, O God, for it is written of me. See, and then like I just mentioned there, you know, Romans 12 and 1. See, that brings us to a place, and even St. Mark had a good account of this when he says in St. Mark 14 and 36, and he said, Abba, Father. See, God brings you and I to a place that you and I could be called the sons of God, that we could also cry, Abba, Father. See, that put us in a place, the very place that Christ prayed, Abba, Father, the Bible says that you and I can pray there also, you know, because we're not fatherless. You know, we have a Father. You know, and I often think about what a pastor said, Eric, when he says, you know, when God just asked him what troubles him, you know, and he just finally responded, you know, what troubles you, son? You know, there's not a greater thing. There's a lot of great things God can say to me. He's saying, hey, you're in a place where you can cry, Abba, Father. You know, that's when he calls you son, that's what you can thereby, from that instance, pray, you know, at that place. And that's the very place that Christ prayed from. You know, that's... So, see, But the Spirit-filled hearts also is always very tender. You know, see, we're talking about going back to Gethsemane. We're talking about, but as thou wilt. You know, do I have a burden? Do I have an anguish for lost people? But then we're tender people. You know, we are to, the love of God is to be shed abroad in my hearts. Do I admit, do I show forth love, you know, from this vessel? And if that's not true of me, you know, if that's not true of you, you know, we have followed the wrong spirit. See, there's a spirit of truth and there's a spirit of error. You know, people, so oftentimes you hear messages preached in such harshness and such... I've seen preachers preach mad. I've seen them preach knowing that they was condemned and they was trying to belittle people but to esteem themselves because they knew they was walking in willful sin. I've seen so many things happen. But it's all the wrong spirit. You know, when I preach to people, you know, I have to be as Christ preached, you know, and even as Paul, you know, when he said he's become all things for all men, you know, let's identify with to whom we're talking to. You know, God wants us to love people, but He also knows and wants us to understand that, you know, we're going to hate sin. That's true. But He also wants us to have a tender heart. And then we must pray and let's obey our way back. You know, if you want to make straight fat paths for your feet, we must begin to do what the Word of God says. That's the only way you can do it. You know, if you can't walk in a straight path, we can't walk that plumb line apart from being obedient to the Word of God. And see, all these things are a part of the blessed Holy Ghost. See, it is the inheritance of us who've been filled. That's what we've been learned. See, when you and I look, it's not what you and I are going to inherit so much. You know, we've inherited, we're looking forward to heaven, we're looking forward to that, but it's what you and I have already inherited. See, we have received something, you know, and as you and I obtain this thing, we work toward that prize of the mark of the high calling in Christ Jesus. See, we begin to inherit this stuff. See, we're going to inherit heaven one day. We're going to get to go there. But see, you and I have also got the kingdom of God in us right now. You know, we do. And what I've received when I received the Holy Ghost, you know, that's what you and I have received. You know, we have received the kingdom of God. And see, as you and I go, you know, if we go into the ministry for the first time, you know, if we... You know, let's have faith in Him. Let's don't as much have faith in our talent or nothing like that, because God said He's going to choose the foolish things to confound the wise. The second I begin to think I have something to offer people, you know, I'll probably fall flat on my face. But, you know, let's believe that it's God that works through you and I. You know, let's don't try to stir up emotions. We see preachers sometimes preach. You can't preach unless the electric guitars are going behind them and stuff. But the truth of God is if I can't make God real to people in the nursing home, you know, you're sitting there, it's so hard to talk to people knowing that they just maybe had an accident on themselves or just puked on themselves. You know, they're in the right mind. See, if I can't make God real to them, you know, what good am I if I'm sitting there and if I can't preach without rock and roll music playing behind me? You see, we stir up emotions too much, and that's, you have to watch stuff like that. You know, emotions can bring tears to your eyes. Emotions can make you feel like doing stuff. But all these emotions, a lot of times, not the Holy Ghost. It's just emotion. And see, so we have to get beyond that. Let's get beyond stirring up of the emotion, but let it be the life of God. See, but faith in what God, let's have faith in what God has put in us. You know, by the virtue of the new birth, but then above and beyond that, by the virtue of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. See, that God has done that for you and I. And see, so I know I've said a lot of things today, but there is an inheritance for the spirit field. You see, not only in the life to come, but in the life that you and I have. Think about what you say when you've been born again. Think about what we're saying. See, you have received the seed of the kingdom of God. See, and we've inherited something. Yeah, God's got plans for us in the future. But you know, but see, we have received something great from Him. So let's believe that. Next week,